like some vulnerable groups who are unable to budget may be exempt, but that would be valid for, so you have to make a case for that, shouldn't be that way. It's obviously a big transition for many people, this transition to single payment. There is a lot of concern last year around the decision to include housing costs, and obviously you can see some potential implications for that. A number of pilots are going on last year about paying housing costs directly to the landlord, and so there's potential that still might be the case in the US at home. Again, the current system of benefits and tax credits allow different benefits and payments to be received by different partners. Universal credit will be paid to one person, so there's some concern, for example, women's groups and domestic violence groups, and actually the one person maybe has to do that for the receipt of the universal credit in Scotland. Okay. I said it's digital by default. The aim is that universal credit will be claimed and maintained and delivered online, with the aim of 80% of claims being registered to. That's around 400,000 transactions per day. However, again, concern and feedback from some of our partners is that we know many low income groups don't have access to computers or don't necessarily have the skills to know how to use them. For example, half of social credit, 60-70% don't have access to computers and no experience of getting online. And we obviously need to prepare those other kind of vulnerable groups who may be in that situation. Okay, so that's a whistle stop tour of I know that the report goes into more detail that we've got there. I'm happy to take any initial questions now. What I've suggested is, you may be familiar that the Economy and Regen Scrutiny Committee have decided to do a scrutiny review around some of the housing concerns and issues. So within welfare reform, we're doing a scrutiny review, particularly around under occupancy and changes to local housing allowance, because that's a kind of particular area of focus for them. So what I've suggested out there is there might be a number of areas that this committee would want to investigate a bit further, maybe particularly relevant to some of the services that we do a little bit more with clients that we work with. So for example, what we see might be implications about the housing policies to be addressed and things like fair access to care that currently I understand brought into turn by the kind of benefits that people want. So those benefits and assessments are changed, what implication might that have for the charging policies. Potentially the replacement of DNA with PIP could further impact on debt charging income. So not least through departments sort of having some scrutiny on these issues, but arguably these issues.
On the transfer to PIP, is the structure the same?
In terms of the assessments?
No, the actual structure of the claim, when you claim on a structured basis. The elements of what you're actually paying for, is it the same?
There's going to be two elements. There'll be a daily living element and a mobility element.
Yeah.
And there'll be individual assessments for both of those. Mm. Is that what you mean?
Well, it's my understanding that one of the elements of the one of the elements that allows you to pay money for support that you can't cook and stuff like that,
there will be some changes in how the assessment is carried out. It's not really exactly the same as the way DNA is assessed, that's for sure. It's a much more medical-focused assessment rather than kind of social, acknowledgement, and disability. So it will be different. We haven't seen the detail of how we're going to
concerned about
Sections 17 is where children need. So we know there's already an increased amount on the council.